The Union River begins as the outflow of three different ponds. The West Branch leaves Great Pond and flows southwest and south. The Middle Branch leaves Lower Middle Branch Pond in Aurora and runs 13.8 miles west and south, where it meets the East Branch in Osborne. The East Branch is the outflow of Rocky Pond and runs 5.3 miles to Spectacle Pond in Osborne, flows out from there, and meanders a further 13 miles northwest, southwest, west, and southwest. East met west in Mariahville, and the powerful confluence headed south toward Ellsworth Falls. The 85-foot drop through the Cascades at Ellsworth Falls to the head of the tide was an ideal location for mills and dams, and in the 1800s, enterprising businessmen built no less than 7 dams here. Joggers and bikers on the shore road can still see a crumbling stone wall, all that remains of the now-forgotten 6th Sawmill Dam. This wall once held Whitcomb, Haynes, and Whitney's lumber pool, where logs waited after the spring drive as mill workers processed the lumber into boards, shingles, staves, or whatever else they were producing that year. During the most active and profitable years of lumber milling on the Union River, from 1830 to 1860, the annual cycle of timber harvesting, milling, and shipping began with the migration of workers deep into the woods of Hancock County each winter. They set up or returned to camps and began taking down timber, hauling it to the frozen river, and stacking it on the ice to wait for the spring river drive. The most efficient way to move timber through the Union River Valley was by floating it along the river to waiting mills. In late April, the river had usually begun to thaw and the annual river drives began. River drivers would maneuver and encourage the logs all the way to Ellsworth. There are at least 2 pieces of oral history about the naming of the Union River, which before the end of the 18th century had been called the Mount Desert River. The most familiar is that the earliest settlers, stopping at what is now called Contention Cove, disagreed where to establish the first community. Some preferred the cove, while others wanted to explore further up the river. An agreement was reached to continue further up the river, and thus the name Union River was established. Another theory is that the surveyor Samuel Livermore noted that the first and second divisions of 12 early townships met at the river. He renamed it the Union River and broke a bottle of rum to commemorate the occasion. At the close of the 18th century, land barons such as William Bingham had an agricultural vision for the frontier lands that included settlers and indigenous peoples alike, based on ideas that had their origin with Thomas Jefferson, soon to be president. Bingham's son-in-law, Alexander Baring, and his agent, General David Cobb, failed to understand that the rich farmlands of Aroostook County and New Brunswick were not the same as the land of northern Hancock County and Washington County. With the rise of Colonel John Black Sr., from an 18-year-old assistant to acquiring power of attorney over the Bingham estate in 1824, came a new focus on the waters of the Union River as the primary resource in land development, as well as for the community that was to become Ellsworth. By 1807, the frontier lands of Hancock County and beyond were starting to be valued more for their timber than for their real estate potential. In the first few decades of the 19th century, Colonel John Black made significant purchases on the Union River that helped establish not only the large-scale harvesting and manufacturing of lumber, but its export throughout the coastal waters of the United States and to ports around the world. The success of this strategic business activity should not be seen as the result of the growing community of Ellsworth, but the reverse. The fact that we have the city of Ellsworth at all today is because of the lumber and shipping trades that took place on the waters of the Union River in the 19th century. Water Street, running parallel to the Union River's eastern shore, was home to wharves, shipyards, sail lofts, shipsmiths, chandleries, and other waterfront industries and businesses. At one time, no less than 18 wharves and docks lined the shore from Cardbrook Cove to the Main Street Bridge. Over the course of a century, John Black's timber empire was divided among many smaller mills, and Ellsworth steadily exhausted the Union River Valley's timber resources. Eventually, even smaller mills could not turn a profit. By 1907, the mills at dam sites 2 through 5 were little more than decrepit symbols of a once booming industry. In that year, the Bar Harbor and Union River Power Company completed a large concrete hydroelectric dam at the location of the first dam and mill site at the head of the tide. Unlike the previous sawmill dam, this new hydro dam blocked the entire river and submerged dams and mill sites 2 through 5. Creating Leonard Lake. In 1923, Bangor Hydro built a second dam upriver at Brimmer's Bridge, flooding hundreds of acres of timberland owned by the last great lumbering firm, Whitcomb, Haynes, and Whitney. In the spring of that same year, the new dam failed, causing large-scale flooding that wiped out most of the riverfront mills and businesses. Finally, the faster delivery of lumber by rail and eventually truck was the capstone on Ellsworth's declining shipbuilding and coasting industry. Thus, the Union River, bloated with sawdust and wood shavings, its salmon and alewives stranded, ended one of its lives. But it wasn't the first life of the river, and it will not be the last. Evidence from archaeology and oral tribal histories tells us that the Union River watershed has been a homeland for Maine's native peoples since the end of the last ice age, about 12,000 years ago. This was due to a wealth of natural resources, including large seasonal salmon and alewife runs. Ellsworth Falls is the archaeological site of a large village, which was in continuous use for more than 5,000 years. For the Wabanaki, or People of the Dawn, the Union River provided transportation, including trade between tribes and fishing. The waters of the Union River also attracted game for hunting. The issues facing the Union River today are timeless. No different today than they were for people of the 19th century or for people from ancient times. The conservation and availability of resources, the purity and safety of the natural environment, and the guarding and maintenance of our ability to connect with the water.